Welcome to the High Energy Lunch Seminar. And today our first speaker is Dr. Randall Smith. Randall is a senior astrophysicist at here. And he got his bachelor's degree from Carnegie Mellon University. And he got his PhD degree from University of Wisconsin-Madison in 1997. And he's an expert on the interstellar medium and maintaining the atomic database. He's also the PI of OPTIS, which is a high-resolution X-ray grating spectrometer. Today he is going to talk to us about OPTIS.
Thanks very much.
So, yes, you may have seen this slide before. This was pick your opening slide because we've been doing ARCUS now for some time. Previously, it was a space station-based mission. But in this case now, we're doing a free-flying satellite mission. It's a $250 million proposal. It's been submitted to the 2016 NASA AO call for MIDEX. Now, we didn't give NASA exclusive rights here, so if any of you happen to have $250 million plus the cost of a launch vehicle, I'm all ears. Or if you have any friends. Okay, so what's the science? This is a grating spectrometer, and the key science for an X-ray grating spectrometer that is substantially larger than anyone we have today is always going to be the WIM. But it's really not just about finding the WIM. If you talk to a theorist, finding the WIM is boring because we already know that the WIM is there. You know, the theory has proven it. So really what we're doing is trying to understand structure formation. We're looking at it, how it's imprinted, not just in the WIM in the very, very distant regions, but in the outskirts of clusters and galaxies where we know there are missing baryons, where galaxies and the clusters don't have all the baryons they should have. They must be somewhere. We're also going to look at feedback from supermassive black holes, specifically the outflows. And here, closer to home, observing the formation and evolution of stellar coronae. What's going on in stars? How do stars form? What are the processes involved? Now, what do we need in order to do this? It's a soft X-ray spectrometer, so it goes from 12 to 50 angstroms. Or for those of you who like to work in KEVs, stop. Learn to work in angstroms. And two, it's a quarter to 1 kV. The resolution is, requirement is greater than 2,500, but the design gets us greater than 4,000. We're leaving ourselves quite a bit of margin, as building these is easier said than done. And more than 450 square centimeters of effective area. Just to sort of give you a concept, that's about Chandra. It's a little bit lighter than Chandra, which means that if you have a source that gives you about one count per second in Chandra, this is going to give you one count per second in ARCUS, or maybe half a count. but it's going to give you spectroscopy at a resolution greater than 2,500. So what can you do with that? So here on the left is sort of the official standard, how are we going to find the WIM figure? And what you're seeing on the x-axis is the equivalent width, and the y-axis is number of filaments per unit redshift with equivalent widths of that value or greater. So this is saying that various three different models here, you'll see, say, if you draw the line of one across there, you'd expect to find one filament per unit redshift with, you know, perhaps a density greater than one, 9 milliangstroms and oxygen 7. That's not really where you want to be. What you really want to be able to do is to find things down at the 2 and 3 milliangstrom level. That's where you can tell the difference. If you can really fill that curve in, you can tell the difference between the different models. On the right is sort of the easy way to see why this hasn't been done before. The black curve is our figure of merit. That's the resolution times the effective area. Take the square root. That's a particularly vicious form of a figure of merit because you can double your resolution and all you get is a factor of 40% better in your figure of merit. But that is the figure of merit for finding an unknown absorption or emission line with unknown position and unknown strength. So if you're just doing a blind search, looking for some sort of absorbing feature somewhere out there in the universe. That's the relevant figure of merit. And the curves there for the XMM Newton and for Chandra show why this is just so hard. Now, you can, in fact, find things with XMM Newton and Chandra if you find a bright enough background source. So this figure here is assuming a moderately bright background source in order to calculate this. But in order to do this with Chandra XMM, you would need an incredibly bright, one of the brightest AGN background sources that you could possibly find. Whereas with Arcus, we'll be able to do this with well-known blazars that have known fluxes and are guaranteed to actually be there and be there stably so we can find them. So that was the key figure for how Arcus is going to get its science done. NASA really loves things like this, by the way. You know, they want to see a figure saying you can't do it with what you've got now. With ours, you can easily do it, and here's the dividing line between those. There are many, many caveats and details to this story, but again, NASA doesn't want to hear them. They want to hear a nice, simple story, and that's it. It's mostly true. Here's the next way of looking. I was talking about that we're not just finding the WIM in unknown places, but we're also looking at the outskirts of clusters and galaxies. So this is measuring the outskirts of clusters and galaxies using essentially pencil surveys. So you imagine that you look out and you've got a background quasar and it's going through the halos of, say, two or three galaxies, maybe a cluster, at some radius. I mean, it's not going to, some of them will go through nearly the center of the cluster at low radius. More of them will go at higher radius. And so then you can stack all these together, assuming, again, a standard lambda CDM or other type cosmology where more or less galaxies and clusters have similar structures in their halo so that stacking them makes sense. And then you plot this curve up. So this is a curve not for one galaxy or one cluster, but a curve shown for actually for a survey of them, different lines of sight. And I plotted here three different possible lines. This one here is a NFW Navarro-Frank-White curve. That's a dark matter, assuming a dark matter, that the baryons follow a dark matter pattern. We don't think that's actually all that likely, but it's at least one extreme. The blue curve, and it goes to r to the minus 3/4, is the curve that would be needed for baryonic matter to follow if all of the baryons in, say, a galaxy were to be within R200. So if you were to say, okay, then you know, we know that we're not seeing all the baryons that should be in a galaxy out to, say, R500, but maybe they all are within R200. If they are, what does that curve have to look like? And it's that blue curve. We don't think that's likely either, but we can show here, we can easily distinguish it from sort of our best guess model here as to what those baryon shapes or baryon profiles look like. Another thing we can do is, and this is where things get easier, and I spent a long time when we were writing this proposal talking to engineers, orbit predictions, satellite makers. They really never understood that curve. This one, I said, however, we're going to study the halo of our galaxy because we're here and we're going to look out and every single line of sight is going to go through the halo of our galaxy and we're going to map that out and know where everything is going. He said, that's great. Why don't you make all your plots that clear? I'm trying. One of the things that we can do is with that data is put together a rotation curve and work out whether or not the halo of our galaxy is stable, non-rotating, or is co-rotating, or is doing something else. You can see current best resolution why we're not doing that today. Although that's not entirely true. Joel Bregman has published a paper based on RGS data, which does his level best at trying to figure out that there actually is some signs of rotation in the halo of our galaxy. But even he will admit it is the best you can do with, you know, really pushing the data to its absolute limit. With Arcus, you can basically just plot the data up, measure the rotation curve, and be done with it. Now, you can do other things as well. A few years ago, there was a big deal talk in here about CMB polarization and measuring that. And you might wonder exactly how X-rays have anything to do with CMB polarization. Well, it turns out that one of the problems that makes that kind of work so difficult is dust foregrounds. And because the dust will emit polarized light in the same bandpass. And exactly how much dust emits depends on how much iron inclusions, how many magnetic inclusions there are in it, and that depends on the kind of magnetic inclusions that you've got in your dust. And if you want to know that, your best way of doing it is to look at the X-rays going through the dust in order to measure the types of dust that you have there. And this curve here is meant to show pretty much by eye. And let me tell you, it's really hard to get a spectrum that you can do by eye. But I would argue that you can tell just by eye that the model that we use to fit is the red one there at the bottom, which has equal amounts of all four of those different iron types. And that the other three models, no matter how you shift them up or down, are not going to give you a good fit. Now, the one thing I can tell you about the real data is it's not going to look like any of these four models, because that's life. But we can spend a lot of time in the lab, make measurements, and figure out what it is that we are seeing. These features are going to be in the data. We have seen hints of this kind of structure in Chandra and XMM Newton data. So we know they're there. We just need higher resolution in order to see it. So ARCUS has three main science goals. Here's the second one. And this one is really to look at the outflows from AGN. Now, I am not really an AGN scientist, but one of the key goals is to understand feedback. How do the outflows affect the material, the environment that they're living in? And an important question to know there is, what's the momentum? What's the mass of those clouds that are outflowing? You might think that that's a known quantity, but it turns out it's actually incredibly difficult to pin down with any accuracy. So the current numbers vary by a factor of 10 due to just uncertainties in the measurements. So then you say, well, how can we do better? And the answer is, well, it is difficult, but if you have a spectrometer with enough resolution and you wait for your source to flicker, so it gets brighter, it gets dimmer, just average everyday AGN being annoying variations, then you will get fluctuations in the photoionization. That changes depending on the radius of the cloud that you're looking at and the density of the cloud. So essentially, by tracking fluctuations in the system itself, as well as using a few of the density-dependent lines that are in this bandpass, using both those features together, you can actually nail down the outflowing gas. You don't get it to 2 or 3%, no. You get it to 30%. But taking something down from a factor of 10 down to 30% accuracy is really going to change the game when you're trying to model just how much power is coming out of these AGN outflows. Our third science goal, as I said, is stars and stellar formation. So this curve, you may have seen this picture before. This is from Nancy Brickhouse's paper done by that noted artist, Andy Sangiorgi. But one of the key things that we can do here is look at the lines. Here are the neon, helium-like neon lines. And there is a huge difference between the lines that are coming from shocks near the surface versus those coming from coronal emission. Right now, it is very difficult to tell those with enough sensitivity in order to know what's going on, but with ARCUS, it's basically a walk in the park. That gives you the ability to understand how the accretion flow is operating. You can then imagine mapping the density, absorbing column, the shock density, all the relevant properties of how a star is forming, how an accreting star is forming using this kind of data. So, I said that we did this before. That mission was known as ISS ARCUS. Actually, it was post-named ISS ARCUS because we like the name ARCUS so much, which, by the way, was due to Mike Novak in the audience. So thanks again to Mike for the good name. It comes from the Roman word for arc or bow. It's not an acronym. That was submitted in 2014. It had similar science goals, slightly lower resolution, slightly less effective area. That was rated as selectable in NASA speak. They're very enthusiastic and hopeful there. Selectable is is what you get. I think Category 1 is very selectable. So we didn't quite get Category 1, but we did get a very strongly positive scientific review with 15 major strengths and no major scientific weaknesses, i.e. they liked it. However, the Technical Management and Cost Panel, known as the TIMCO in Explorer speak, felt that the optics and gratings technologies were not as ready as they needed to be. What they really wanted to see was an actual laboratory demonstration showing that we had the gratings and the optics working at the level that we said we needed them to work at. Essentially, the team said it's a fair cop. We had done as much as we could at the time, but we simply just didn't have the technology quite where we wanted it to be. So where are we today? Well, here's what the actual mission looks like. So we'll walk through it here. In section A up there, you'll see we have four petals of optics. So the petals are arranged using silicon pore optics. So you see there in the lower left under E. Those are the same kind of optics that are going to be used for Athena. They have a number of advantages for us. One, they meet our requirements in terms of effective area and point spread function. They don't yet meet the Athena point spread function requirements, but they do meet the Arcus ones, which is all we care about. They are made by computer. They're made by a robot, which means their costs are extremely well known. Their schedule is extremely well known. You pay Cosine, the company, to make them. Cosine will give you them after you send them the money. It's a very simple and pleasant arrangement. So that's a great simplicity for us. You can see in the front there we have thermal precollimators. That's in order to keep our heat losses down. And doors in front of those, just because it's nice to have doors. The pedals then have the optics here, and behind them, the MIT critical angle transmission gratings, which could easily be the topic of a hour-long talk all by themselves. This, however, should probably be given by Ralph Heilemann or Mark Schattenberg, not myself. So I will simply note here that here's an example of a CAT grating. The grating is in here. It's mounted into a holder that we built here at SAO. That will all again get mounted into the pedal there. That disperses the light. It goes through a extendable optical boom. So that's a 12-meter optical boom that extends. It launches, collapsed, and then expands out. There'll be a sock around that, which isn't shown. Here we have the back end. You have two arrays of CCDs. There are 16 total CCDs in Arcus in two groups of eight. Each CCD is twice the width of a Suzaku CCD. And the same height. So there's actually quite a bit of silicon here. If you think about it, that's essentially necessary because we have a wide bandpass and an extremely high resolution. If you're going to get that to work, you need to have a lot of pixels in order to separate out your array. There's simply no way around it. Then we have the various detector electronics, the ICU, which is actually nearly a rebuild of the one that was used on SWIFT that comes from Penn State. And the spacecraft, which is not shown in the back here, is being built for us by Orbital ATK down in Dulles, Virginia. So it's an exciting thing. You get to fly down to Dulles and you go about 5 minutes away from the building and you're there. So what are we going to achieve? I said greater than 450 square centimeters. That was at oxygen 7. And you can see there we have actually three main requirements at oxygen 7, oxygen 8, and carbon 6. And essentially, there's our curve. The main reason why it's dropping at longer wavelengths is because we have filters in front of the detectors in order to block optical and infrared light. We're hoping to make those thinner. That would give us a more throughput at longer wavelengths. For comparison, there at the bottom, I'm showing the XMM Newton and the Chandra curves. And you can see that, again, it's not quite a fair comparison because, again, the resolution that we're getting is much, much higher than, say, XMM Newton, although XMM Newton does have almost 100 square centimeters in various places. So it's a trade-off one way or the other. On the right-hand side, you can see the actual grating efficiencies. Those have now been remeasured using an even newer CAT grating all the way out to 50 angstroms, and we're now getting about 35% efficiency from about 20 angstroms out to 50 angstroms. So we really are hitting the grating efficiencies that we need. There's even plans for a grating that would get us out to 50% efficiency. Actually, opinions vary on that one, because although I would love to get 50% efficiency, one of the other things is these telescopes also work out to about 10 kV, and we get the zero order. So at the same time we're getting all of this light, the zero order, which is basically everything that isn't So right now it's say 65%, is coming down and hitting our detectors and giving us the bandpass from 1 to 10 kV as well. Now it's only giving us to us at CCD resolution. But if, for example, it would be really helpful to somebody's science to have both high resolution and soft bandpass and a much wider bandpass, albeit with lower resolution, we'll get that with ARCUS. Now, this curve is going to take me just a moment to explain, but because it was addressing the primary point that the TIMCO didn't like last time, I think it's probably worthwhile. So on the left-hand side is, in sort of the brownish colors, is the silicon pore optics point spread function with the finite source contribution removed. We get 1.42 arc seconds full width half max. That was measured at the Marshall Stray Light facility. I would just like to put a plug out there for the Marshall folks who went way above and beyond to help us get these measurements. Jeff Kajajak spent many late nights helping us to get these, because they all came in within a few months of us putting the proposal in when the silicon pore optic was ready. The point of this graph here is to show that the PSF of the silicon pore optic is not a dot. It's actually a line. And so you can sort of see the line here. This is the direction that we're going to be dispersing the light in, and you can see that's quite narrow. In the cross-dispersion direction, it's quite a bit broader. But that doesn't really matter. We're dispersing the light in the other direction. So now you look at passing that light through a cat grating, and that's the curve in blue on the right-hand side here. Now, here's where things get a little bit trickier, because what you'd love to have is essentially a zero-width emission line to measure with, much like, you know, here with the left-hand side, we've got the finite source contribution because the source is at finite size. That's a 1.1 arc seconds. You'd like to have a point photon or a point source that gives you a delta function line. Tragically, the universe is not filled with such things. What it is filled with is with bright lines, sources like aluminum K alpha. That gives you a line width, a natural line width of 3.4 arc seconds full width half max. However, putting through everything, we got a measured line spread function of 4.2 arc seconds full width half max, and when you take out the natural line width of the line, 2.47, which is substantially better than our requirement. So this means that we now have laboratory data from the Stray Light facility of both the optics meeting our requirement and the optics plus the gratings meeting our requirement, with the actual mounted in a flight-like-ish configuration after doing environmental tests. So we shook these, we ran them through temperature excursions, and then we measured them, and everything works. The nice thing about working with cat gratings is that their alignment requirements are actually, as far as this business goes, reasonably loose. So the top left there, you can see what the requirements are. Now, it might seem like getting, say, half a millimeter in and out in the z-axis on a 12-meter focal length mission is not so easy, but I am assured by the engineers that they can do that. It's when you get down to plus or five microns that things get dicey. Over here on the right, you can see our requirements. So, for example, that first term, the transverse PSF, our requirement is 2.0. And if you remember that the measurement that we got was 1.42. So not only do we have met our requirement, we've got a margin of 40% on that requirement. Similarly, with the gratings line spread function down here, sort of in the middle of this curve, we have a 2.3 arc second requirement, and we've measured 1.7. So we are essentially able to address all of those major issues already. Coming to the end here, what's the mission going to look like? We're going to be in a lunar resonant orbit. This orbits the Earth essentially four times for every one orbit that the Moon makes. It uses the Moon to stay in this orbit. This orbit has a number of advantages. It's higher than the Chandra orbit, for example. It never goes through the belts, so we don't have the problem of belt passages and the resulting damage to the CCDs. We can essentially orbit for about 6 to 7.5 days. Then we come close to the Earth, which gives us a good chance to download all the data at a fairly high data rate. So essentially, the mission operations is made substantially simpler than this. The only disadvantage of this, only significant disadvantage of this orbit, is that you do get a fair number of eclipses. You get they come reasonably often, but the top left there shows you that you get a lot that are shortish, less than 2 hours, and you get a few that are longer than that. So you have to design your satellite to survive sort of a 4 hour, 5 hour eclipse that will hit reasonably regularly. But if you can do that, then the rest of it's pretty straightforward. Operations are shown here. In this case, we'll be using the Ames Mission Ops Center. They have controlled a number of missions. Currently, they're controlling Kepler at their Mission Ops Center. The Science Operations Center will be here at SAO. Data will be stored in the HESARC, and spacecraft support will be provided by Orbital ATK. So to summarize, those of you who are on the team, and I see a number of you out there will recognize this. This is from our fact sheet, which we spent many weeks putting together. But I'll just leave that up there and take any questions. Thanks very much. We are hoping to convince them to kick in. They have agreed so far to allow us to use all of their GSE. So, for example, Cosine, the company, is making the optics, but the robots and all the stuff that Cosine uses to do that are owned by ESA. ESA's given us explicit permission to use that so that Cosine doesn't have to worry about the propriety of it all. They have not yet agreed to pay for it. If we get a Phase A study, we're going to make a pitch. They seem to be interested, but essentially it's an ESA politics thing that until you have a more stable possibility of a mission, they're not interested in putting money up.
Just another question. At one point, I thought you were favoring the Alzheimer's gradient. When did you switch?
We switched right around the time of these tests because the off-angle gradings showed partial success and partial not meeting requirements, whereas the CAT gradings worked on all cylinders. And it was a very tough decision. And not one of my favorite weeks of my life, but we then essentially made the decision that having one technology that met all of our requirements was the way to go.
Who's going to launch it?
It'll be launched in Kennedy. They will not tell us what kind of rocket, although most likely it'll be a Falcon 9.
It's a SpaceX.
SpaceX. Yeah. But they won't. They just give you the specs of the a possible launcher. They won't tell you which one it's going to be.
That's
NASA's decision. Yeah.
When you hear the
answer? We will find out if we get a Phase A study, which is the down select to the next level, probably in August. And then there will be a further down select from the two or three that get Phase A studies, and that will probably find out in January of 2019. You'll know if we got the down select because you'll never see me again starting August 1st.
All right. I don't know if you can hear me like this. All right.
Just a second.
All right. So hello, everyone. Thank you so much for the introduction. So I'm going to talk about a little bit of the work that I've been doing for the last year, I would say. I would like to acknowledge the contributions from all my collaborators. Some of them are in Europe and some of them are in Hearing House. So this is basically, I will be talking about stellar magnetic fields and how these magnetic fields are influencing the environment of exoplanetary systems. Since this is a very broad audience, I would like to start with kind of just a little bit of motivation. So we are aiming to get some better understanding of all these sorts of very complex phenomena, from the high energy emission of the host star, the coronal structure, the stellar wind, how this is impacting the planetary conditions. This also includes transient phenomena as flares, CMEs, all of this activity that we observe in the sun. And it goes all the way up to the edges of the solar system, or in the stellar cases, the astrosphere. So all of this is influenced by the stellar magnetic field. And we want to tackle this problem with kind of a combination of both, kind of advanced observational techniques and detailed numerical simulation. So I will start right here, and basically it's a little bit of an overview of magnetic fields and astrophysics. So this, when you think about these two things, you need to think about the Zeeman effect and the spectropolarimetry. The Zeeman effect, maybe all of you know this, but it was basically, since more than 100 years ago, the first measurement of an astrophysical object, a sunspot, where you basically see these kind of patterns where you have a slit positioning on a sunspot, you will get the split of the on the spectral lines, as you can see here in this beautiful image. And the line splitting is proportional to the strength of the magnetic field and the wavelength of the line. So if you go to the red, this effect gets greater. So think about that when you're thinking about M dwarfs in the future. So the G factor there is kind of a proportional factor that tells you how sensitive is the line to the magnetic field itself. Sometimes you can calculate it from these expressions. There are some lines which we have no idea what is the line factor so far. So the Zeeman effect also influences the polarization state in the light and introduces a particular type of polarization in each component. So this is a schematic view of the Zeeman splitting. You have no magnetic field on the left, magnetic field on the right, so you got your splitting. You have three components, one with less energy, one with more energy. But when you look at the polarization, depending on where you are, these components will come with different states of polarization. Some of them will be circularly polarized, some of them will be linearly polarized. So the bottom line is, if you know the splitting and the polarization state of the light, in principle, you can recover the vector properties of the magnetic field. And this is kind of the task for doing this in astrophysics. So the polarization state of the light is usually expressed in the terms of this Stokes parameter, in the Stokes parameter formalism. This is just a clever way of mathematically express how the polarization is behaving. So basically, from an observer's point of view, the polarization can be expressed in these clever ways of different polarizations in different angles. So what is important here is that they correspond to plus and minuses of intensity, so therefore they can be measured. So when we speak about spectroscopy, we're usually just talking about Stokes' eye. But when I talk about spectropolarimetry, you have to include the other components. As you can imagine, this is, of course, at the cost of more time on the telescope. So that's why spectropolarimetry is expensive time-wise. Right. So this is the current landscape on high-resolution spectropolarimetry. Basically, almost every single paper that you will see, they will come from these instruments and telescopes. These are the different resolutions, a wavelength coverage, and this is kind of a little bit of the future because basically there has been identified that there's a strong synergy between the people that is studying the stars and the people that want to understand the planets around them. So basically, as you will see here, all of these two first instruments are getting an upgrade or just maybe being refurbished to other instruments where they're actually getting a better precision in the RVs, and we will get finally a high-resolution spectropolarimeter on an 8-meter class telescope. So this will open really a lot of windows for the future. So one of the techniques that you will hear a lot about in this talk is Zeeman Doppler imaging. So basically, this is a tomographic inversion technique, which is based on time series of these spectropolarimetric observations, which is aimed to reconstruct the magnetic field that is generating this time series, these patterns. So usually it's only done with circular polarization, and the reason for this is because the linear polarization signature is usually at least 10 times weaker than the circular polarized light. There are several requirements of this technique, but at the end, what you recover is a large-scale magnetic field distribution on the surface. So this technique is basically has inherited the properties of what is called the Doppler imaging technique. This is kind of a schematic of how this works. If you have a surface inhomogeneity in the surface in the star, if it's close to the pole, you will see a small distortion in the core of the line. But if it's closer to the equator, you will see this traveling across the entire profile. In the case of polarized radiation, each magnetic field component would induce this particular signature in the Stokes profile. So if you have a purely radial field, your signature will only get bigger as it's crossing. while if you have an azimuthal component, it will actually make a sign, a shift in the sign. So you have to be careful because this was developed for fast rotators. So when you're applying this to slowly rotating stars, you have to be very careful to not be tricked by possible artifacts. All right, so these are some examples of how you will actually see this in the literature. So this is usually presented in a Mercator projection, like in the left one, or like this polar view. So basically you have the radial, azimuthal, and meridional components. You have latitude and phase or longitude. The field strength is color-coded, and you will see that actually the latitude is not completely covering the entire star, and this is because Riemann Doppler imaging cannot observe portions of the star because it's limited by the inclination of the star itself. And this is another projection here. This is, we are looking basically from top of the star. You have your magnetic fields are here, basically connected here and right in the pole, and then all of these circles are basically telling you 30 degrees of latitude. These tick marks that you're seeing in the top here and around the circle are basically when we were observing the star. So if you see a map, something like this, but it has very little tick marks on top, this means that you have to be careful about what you're interpreting there. And these are basically telling you how many observations were used to recover this map. All right, so with all of this information, this is what the kind of the landscape right now, it's a little bit outdated right now, I haven't been able to find this figure. But this is basically how the magnetic field looks like in cool main sequence stars. See, this plot is actually known as the confusogram because there's so much in there that it's a little bit kind of complicated to put all of this in the same plot. I will try my best to explain it. So basically the sizes of the AH symbol represent the field strength. So it's saturated between 3 at the smallest, it's probably the sun, and the largest is 1.5 kilogauss, which are these guys over here in the M dwarfs. The color represents the geometry of the field. So if it's red, it's completely toroidal field. If it's blue, it has a significant toroidal component, so basically something that is wrapping up around the star. And the shapes represent the symmetry. So if you have a kind of decagonal shape, if it's going tending to a circle, it's very axisymmetric. If it's a star shape, it's completely non-axisymmetric. So the two cases that I showed you before are these two guys, Saibu A and that M dwarf over there, the big one. All right. So there's more examples. So this is work that I've done during the last year during my PhD, and this is some reconstructions of particularly active sun-like stars which actually happen to have host some planets. So this is, again, you're seeing there the Stokes V polarization time series, and in the right side you have the ZEI reconstructions. As you can see, for instance, from the bottom panel, the quality of your data will actually limit the amount of details that you can actually put in these maps. So this is something you need to take into account when you're using this map for whatever other part of your research. So there's a lot of things that you can do with the set Zeeman Doppler imaging maps, and you can try to tie them in with another observables like activity and so on. But for the rest of this talk, I will try to put them in the context of what we're doing from the numerical point of view. So, and for this, we go for the data-driven numerical simulations. And for this particular part of the work, we are using the so-called space weather modeling framework. This is a set of models that has been developed for the heliophysics domain. So basically, it's a set of MHD models that are being used to simulate the entire environment of the sun, starting from the solar corona. So what you're seeing here is a model comparison. The top row is model simulated images in coronal emission lines. And in the bottom panel is observations. As you can see, this is doing a pretty good job, at least for describing this particular solar simulation. And this is state-of-the-art 3D MHD code, high performance. You need big machines to run this, but includes a lot of the physics that we think that is happening, that are occurring in the solar system domain. So you have alpha and wave turbulence hitting your corona, driving up your stellar wind. You have radiative cooling effects. You have a lot of kind of this physics is embedded in there. And one of the inputs of this code, and this is critical, is in the case of the sun, you will require the so-called Carrington maps. So this is basically magnetic field maps of the sun as in kind of synthesized during one rotation. And this is more or less analogous to what we get from ZEI, although there are several differences, so you have to be aware of them. So this is a couple of examples of things that we have been doing with this space weather modeling framework in the case of the sun, because we always want to try to go back to the star that we know the best, the star we have more constraints, so that we are not generating models that make pretty much no sense. So we want to generate models that actually are somewhat comparable to what we know about the sun. you can also model not only the corona, but also you can start. I will be coming after this. So in the coronal structure for the particular star that I showed you before, this is a little bit how the solutions look like. So you, what you're seeing here is the surface of the star. Some coronal field lines are there. This is in the top panel is color-coded by the particle density, and the middle panel is colored by temperature. And you see several features in the star, basically some dark features in temperature, lower densities. This will be some coronal holes, some high energy, high density features with lower temperatures. It will be some sort of filaments. And from there, you can actually do a little bit or more numerical and quantitative studies. So you can actually calculate the measure distributions of this corona. And then from there, you can generate synthetic spectra that can be served or used to calibrate your images. So these simulated images of those corona in the soft X-ray emission band. So you can do kind of this workaround to compare to whatever observations you have. How good is this corona model? Is it good? Is it failing? And this is some of the work that we have done before. You can also go and do some wind simulations. And again, we start with the solar wind. And this is kind of a textbook picture of the solar wind simulation. So in here, we're actually changing the domain of the simulations. The simulations that you were seeing before were very close to the star, but now we are going much further away. So this is a 2 astronomical unit box. The white sphere in the center is a 23 radius. So the star is actually inside. But the problem is we cannot simulate the entire domain because there are two large gradients in every astrophysical quantity. So it's color-coded by density in the equatorial plane, and the kind of these shades that you're seeing, the green one and the purple one, is actually the solar wind component. So you get this fast wind coming out of the poles and this low wind going around the equator and this ballerina skirt shape. So as soon as you move to solar maximum, the situation gets much more complicated. You have a density increase, complexity increase, the wind is significantly slower, and you get a lot of more complex situation in this case. So we have done similar things for other stars, and this is, for instance, HD1237. This is a planet-hosting star, a very active sun-like star. It's located in the south. We recovered the SETDI maps using Hubble's pole data, and this is a similar plot as the one you saw before, but this is a completely different topology. And here I'm kind of showing a little bit how this looks like. Inside there, you have your star. You have the magnetic field configuration is given by SETDI, and then you drive this entire simulation. So you can calculate things like mass loss rate, angular momentum loss, and so on. So all of these properties could be interesting for stellar evolution and so on. This particular system has a Jupiter mass planet in a, let's say, eccentric orbit, and it goes as close as 0.25 astronomical units. So we decided that we could actually do more. So there are two boxes here. I mean, showing you some other simulations that we perform because we actually can tie in magnetosphere simulations about this of this system, and you get these very strong wind exoplanet interactions around the orbit. And we're actually even able to potentially tell you how much radio emission from this interaction is generating. And this is potentially detectable. The only problem is the location of this system in the sky, which is basically unobservable for every radio telescope. So and you can do even more generic things, like, for instance, characterize the stellar winds and the habitable zone of this system. So this is this kind of connection with the exoplanet community. And so, for instance, what you're seeing here is these rings are basically denoting different distances from the host stars. You have the 1 astronomical unit distance, and you have 2 different boundaries, the optimistic inner habitable zone and the conservative inner habitable zone. So you can know how much is the wind density, wind speeds, and temperatures, and all of these MHD properties of the wind. So in this sense, this methodology can provide you a dynamical determination of the habitable zone inner boundary. So you can take into account the stellar wind properties, the activity level of the host star. We can trace with observation with SETDI. We can model with our coronal models. And we can even go further and try to test different planetary magnetospheric shielding. So this is a little bit of what we have done so far. But let me go back to this plot. And there's one key element that is missing in this plot. And this element is actually time. So this is not, it cannot be a static picture. Like every single point here, you can imagine that it's actually changing time. And it's actually changing in a time scale that is comparable to our normal time scales. So how do we know with this? Well, we know that because stars have cycles and they vary a lot. So this is the sun, and this is just showing you the large-scale magnetic field of the sun. So everything that is green here is positive polarity coming out now, right now from the North Pole. There is the date over there. And the purple one is negative polarity. So as time evolves, the sun actually gets a lot of changes in this magnetic field. And there, basically, at some point, you will see that basically the negative polarity took over the North Pole. The positive polarity went down. And this is basically critical information that we need in order to understand how the magnetic field on the sun works and basically how the magnetic field in every other astrophysical, at least stellar, object works. So this is critical for the people that is doing dynamo and all of our understanding of magnetic fields in astrophysics in general. So we also know this from other proxies. So this is probably a very famous plot. So this is the butterfly diagram, probably one of the longest time series in astrophysics. You have here date. Basically, you're seeing there is the latitude, and you see these dots of different colors. It's basically the amount of sunspots that you will get in the sun. Just look at the numbers here. They're really tiny numbers, so we only can generate these plots because we have the sun right next door. So, and in the bottom panel is a year's activity. You know that in the sun there's this connection with the black line here. If you look at the region that is actually highly magnetic, you will see kind of this emission in the course of the calcium H and K lines in the blue. And again, now I'm showing you here, the sun is on top, and some other more active stars are showing this kind of oscillation pattern. And so several chromospheric cycles have been observed. But as soon as you go to more active stars, the situation gets much more complicated. So you start losing kind of this coherence in the way that these activity cycles appear. So I said before, it should be much more easier to see it in the X-rays, but it turns out that from all of these stars, there are only four, and maybe somebody in the audience would say, oh, this year we know that there are five with Proxima Cent. Fair enough, but only four of these systems have X-ray coronal counterparts detected, and three of them are binaries. So in a binary system, they're much more complicated. I think we don't understand a single star magnetic-wise. I don't think we can do it in binaries yet. So what is the other star? And this is what the rest of my talk will be. And this is Iota Orologi. So this is a very particular object because it's basically a sun-like star. It's very similar to a sun. It has the very kind of conspicuous age, so 650 mega-years old. It's basically the age when life arose in the solar system. So this is great for proposals. So you have a rotation period of around a third of the solar rotation period. And this is a little bit of how zoom in into the activity cycle of this star. So what you're seeing in blue is the calcium H and K measurements, and what you're seeing in red is a long-term monitoring campaign with XMM Newton, where basically the X-ray coronal cycle has been observed. It has been determined that it has a 1.6-year cycle, which is actually the shortest activity cycle to date. And this is great, because if you want to do monitoring or stuff, you don't want to wait for 11 years, 20 years. You want to do it quick, right? You don't have your entire, you cannot survive all that time. So what you're seeing here also is part of what we have been doing. So basically, there are some diamonds in this plot. These are basically coming from observing campaigns that we started the ending of 2015. We decided to do ZDI with the best of our capabilities to try to see what's happening with the magnetic field on this star. So every single kind of set of diamonds there's going to be a ZDI reconstruction for that epoch. So we have been submitting proposals to ESO from period 96. There are four proposals already. All of them have been accepted. And at the same time, we're monitoring the star with XMM Newton. So Jorge is the PI of that program. I'm the PI on the Hartzfeld program. And so we're trying to follow this up as much as we can. So right now, as we speak, the people in La Silla is observing the star for us, not right now, but in the night. And this observation will be actually simultaneous with XMM Newton. So this information is extremely valuable because we can use the X-ray information to constrain our models to see that if our models are doing crazy things or not. So this is, and probably this is one of the very few data sets that you will get this information. So our proposal in P99, you can see this, but whatever, there's something that it was supposed to appear in P99 was approved. And our proposals for the next year was approved on XMM Newton as well. So we will have four more X-ray data points covering the regions that I'm showing you here. So our aim is basically to finish this up at least to P100 of the ESO periods. Who knows, we maybe continue even further. I don't know if I will be able to do that, but let's see. So I will show you some of the first results that we have. So I have here the same plot as before, and I'm going to show you some ZEI maps. This is how they look like. They don't really show extremely well in this monitor. So what you're seeing here is the radial, meridian, and azimuthal component. The dotted line is the visibility limit that I told you, because the inclination angle of iota or is around 60 degrees. And we have this color-coded by the polarity of the field. So in blue is negative, red is positive. And as you can see here, it's kind of mixed polarity regions in the radial field, but this very strong and localized azimuthal field with negative polarity. And in the meridional field, there's not so much information, and this is basically what you get because our reconstructions are only done with the Stokes V, not with the full Stokes. It's very difficult to do that. This is how the Stokes, the circular polarization profile. There are a couple of not very great weather nights, but still we managed to reconstruct the epoch, and we have a 1.5 more or less phase coverage on this epoch. And this plot here is probably the most important plot of this entire presentation, which I'm not going to talk too much about it, but it's basically is a way that we have developed in order to be able to compare systematically ZEI observation between each other and between stars. And this is extremely important because ZEI is plagued with systematics. So you have to be very careful when you're comparing one map with another map or even maps from the same star. So if you want to get kind of sense of what your conclusions are actually real from the magnetic field itself or not by, you know, some artifact that the technique is introducing or by the phase coverage or by the noise in your data. All right, so this will get a little bit colorful here. So here we are. This is a close-up on the activity cycle here. Again, the red is just a sine curve that we put there. Red is X-rays. Blue is the calcium HNK. All of these are our measurements here. And that is exactly the same azimuthal field that I started before. This was the map obtained in October 2015. And as we move towards in the front of the cycle, you will see that how this azimuthal field gets stronger and stronger and kind of localized closer to the equator. Notice the difference in the color scale in each one of these maps as we are progressing. We think that something really happened here around the maximum. Unfortunately, the weather in La Silla was terrible, so our next reconstruction is not as great as you can see from the tick marks on top. We don't have too many points, too many measurements there in this particularly critical location, which is unfortunate. We will be able to try it again in the next year. As we move on, kind of the azimuthal field gets weaker and weaker. And then here you start to get this kind of mess, this complex configuration of things moving to one side or the other side with different polarities. And then later on, you will see that now basically the dominant polarity is positive. So, and this is actually confirmed in our last epoch. So basically we started from a negative polarity in the azimuthal field. And after 1 year on observations, this has been transformed into a positive. This is extremely complicated to interpret from the point of view of the solar paradigm, because we don't see these azimuthal fields in the sun. So we actually see the polarity changes in the radial field, but we don't really know exactly where are these azimuthal fields are coming from. So in the radial component, the situation is a little bit similar, although if you remember, we started with this particularly strong azimuthal field in this epoch, but in here we see this mixed polarity. And it's only 1 month later or 2 months later that you actually see the negative polarity positioning in the top, or basically in the pole of the star. As soon as we're progressing, you get much more complex field. They don't look great in this monitor, but they look great here. So basically you have a lot of negative polarity on top, a lot of a small kind of mixed polarity closer to the equator. This progresses, and even though that this looks darker here, the color scale is much more different. So that is minus 55 Gauss. This is only minus 10. Actually, the field is very weak in this epoch. And again, the field remains stable in the radial field. So you don't see too many differences between these three maps. So basically, they are separated by 3 months or so, which is significant in this 1.6 year cycle. Then kind of you see that the radial field in the top starts to get weaker, and then it's not completely done yet, but we are expecting that at some point the radial field will take over the north pole of the star. So we will be able to see if this is actually happening maybe 1 week when the new HARPS data set will be finished. So now with every single one of these maps, you can actually do all the modeling work that I spent 10 minutes talking about. So I am not going to show all of that right now. All of you will be dizzy about it. But I will just say a little bit about the planet. So basically, this planet is the planet that, the first planet that was discovered with an ESO instrument, that this is also great for proposals. And this is how the radial velocity signature looks like. And these are the properties. It's a two Jupiter mass planet in a relatively low eccentricity, although I'm not entirely sure about those numbers right now because of my new data. But it's close to one astronomical unit. And depending who you ask, this will be completely in the habitable zone or completely out, right? Like, so whatever. So our idea is actually to start to understand what's happening with this system and the entire environment of this system using all the information that we have at hand with ZDI and our modeling approach. So I'm showing you again here the cycle, the same plot as before, and now we're basically able to simulate the entire environment of IOTA orology through its magnetic cycle. This has never been done before in so much great detail. And on top of that, with so many constraints. And this is important because when you're a modeler, you can basically do very beautiful models, but your imagination can go wild. You really need to come back to Earth at some point. So, and this is density, how density is distributed around the star. So you see density color-coded in every single one of them. And you see how actually, just by eye, this middle thing, the one in the middle is actually a little bit redder. And this is just because we're getting close to the point where actually the emission, or we're expecting higher emission from the corona, from the X-rays, from all these closed loops there. Of course, this wouldn't be a simulation if we don't make this turn. And we have also the temperature. So again, you see all this very hot plasma containing these coronal loops, kind of how the corona is evolving with the magnetic cycle. We not only do the corona, but we also know a little bit about the wind. This is similar plots as before. So in here, actually, this box is encoding three astronomical units because the planet and the habitable zone is a little bit farther away. The star is hotter. So we want to characterize the habitable zone as well. So that's why the simulation box is larger. And this is, again, showing you exactly the same. The green one is the fast wind. Purple one is the slow wind. And you see color-coded by particle density how the wind is evolving through the magnetic cycle of the star. And this information is basically only known, and I will put quotes on that, for the sun. So and we know we can estimate the amount of mass loss and amount of angular momentum loss at different epochs, such as well with the characterization of these habitable suns that we have here. So remember, we can do this for every single map that I showed you before, and this is not over yet. We have at least one more year of data coming in. So I will just end up kind of summarizing. I will not repeat everything that I've said before. But we are doing kind of linking together the stellar magnetic field as the main driver of this, all of this stellar planetary environment of planet hosting stars and the sun. So the methodology is ZDI-driven exospace weather modeling. We take everything we know from the solar system and we try to apply it to other stars, modeling the corona, stellar wind, habitable zone conditions, astrospheres, and so on. So we're starting to dig into this kind of situation of the activity and magnetic cycles. We're trying to characterize them. We know a great deal about chromospheric activity, not so great in coronal activity. And the spectropolarimetry plus ZDI is a big question mark because it's not entirely clear how the results from ZDI actually go together with the chromospheric and coronal activity ones. It's a little bit complicated. There's one remarkable system which I'm spending, I think, all my life on it. I want to get it done. So a single G0 star, this is great. The ones with activity cycles that we know, coronal cycles are binary, so I don't like that. Has a calcium and X-ray cycle, has the shortest cycle to date. We are building up probably the most precise long-term ZDI monitoring to date. Has moderate rotation, which is good, because this actually means that we can recover the ZDI map, but at the same time, we can try another things. One of them is try to differential rotation measurements. We can try Zeeman broadening measurements. There's another things that we can try on that. I didn't mention this. But it has precise half stereo seismology, so you know to a good extent the property, the internal properties of the star. It has a consistent age, which is extremely difficult to find for a field star because this is a star that is confirmed, a confirmed ejected member of the Hyades. So this basically puts your age in very constrained. It's a confirmed Jupiter mass planet at one astronomical unit. That this is great for proposals. And who knows, there might be even more there. So my hope is that if we have a precise understanding of the activity of the subject, with all of these characterization campaigns, that all of this effort, we might be able to say more, maybe find more planets there. I'm trying to do that right now. It's not going great, but let's see. So thank you so much for your attention. Yeah, it's a low frequency one. Yeah. Yeah, the problem is the star is located at minus 80 declination. So it's a southern object. It was done with HARPS. So it's a very active star. It's an eccentric orbit. It's a 3 Jupiter mass planet. So if you only scale the magnetic field of the planet, then you expect a lot of emission. So there were previous estimates doing some rough numbers, some estimations of the stellar wind, but our stellar wind models are much more precise. So we actually refined previous estimates of that. And we come up with a number that was kind of falling in between what people were predicting before. But still, it's not possible to observe that. Maybe with SKA, that one will do it.
Stellar wind models, as I understand it, are really snapshots based on the ZDI measurements.
That's correct.
Can you stars rotate, and that has an effect on the wind? So, can you model that rotation and the effect?
So,
have you done that?
The ones that I showed are the so-called steady state solutions. So actually, rotation is included, but basically the simulation converges until basically the wind is not changing anymore. But you can actually do time-dependent simulations as well. And this is something that we are actually doing right now, but not exactly for the wind part, but for transient events. For transient events. So we are actually trying to simulate things like CMEs. Yes,
okay.
And in these environments. But this is computationally very expensive.
Yeah.
So we are doing that. This is part of what I've been doing here. But it wasn't ready for this presentation yet. But at some point, I will talk about that here. Thank you so much.
Yeah, well, I have more reasons to talk.
Sorry? Yeah, sure. I will.